Hi, everybody. It's Cubby from the Prophecy 222 channel. I was just going to mention some recollections that I have had. I'd first like to mention that I want you to all to know that I don't have any problems or issues with you all thinking that I'm a nut or just, you know, somebody just wandering along foolishly, aimlessly, and just delusional, let's just say, or saddenly delusional, and I don't have a problem with that. And I really don't even want to be doing this. Actually, that's not true. I don't mind doing this. I kind of enjoy putting the music aside on it and whatnot. Which, just to let you know, all the music that I've been playing, I give credit to Free Play. It's a website that gives you, everybody, all these beautiful, wonderful, hardworking individuals with a love for creativity of music, freely giving their music out. So I don't have to worry about YouTube and copyright issues that they may have if I put the wrong music on. So I hope you do enjoy. All I do is I go out and I grab a selection, and I just pretty much just drop it in. I mean, stuff that I enjoy that I feels like it might go with, you know, the emotional aptitude of what I'm speaking about, I guess. I'm doing this for my own selfish purposes, because I do have fun throwing together things and finally maybe getting my mind, all the thoughts, on to somewhere else and to other people. I mean, when I started speaking of this around to the family, they all thought I was, you know, going off the bend, that I would actually take a dream like that for reality of an angel coming to me. And I didn't, actually. And I let it go. But there were a multitude of issues within that dream that even were prophetic for my own personal life. So I don't really know if that is a worldwide prophetic thing or if it's just for myself. Because when I told you that I seen an angel, here are some coincidences. A neighbor moved in just a few doors into one of the other buildings across the way, and I could clearly see she put a big statue of an angel right at her front door, you know, like, well, it's 2-3 feet tall, you know, not big. So, you know, coincidentally, it was an incorporation of her coming, I guess, I don't know. And then when I walked out and I had this peaceful feeling of non-fear, I feel that now. I feel that now when I walk out. I used to have an anxiousness, the people around me and that, but I don't feel that issue anymore. Things have changed for me in that aspect. And when I got to the very end of the walkway, oh, and the plane that was pitching up and whatnot, there was horrible, humongous accidents going on with one of the ships that were going to the outer space. I don't remember if Discovery or whatnot had happened right after that dream. And an airplane did that, as a matter of fact, too, right after that. See, there are so many coincidences that this all could be just blah blah, you know, and wasting my time and everybody's time. Why would I do it? I do it because I have faith in the Almighty Creator. That was I chosen? I have no idea. I profess that I dream and pray and think that not, that it's just foolish delusions. Who in their right mind, who in a good heart, you know, somebody who loves everyone, would want any kind of harm and death upon the world just to be right or something of that aspect? I very much hope and pray that I am continually stupidly wrong and that I can just finally drop this and go on with my life. So yeah, is it a test to see whether or not I can finally walk away, that I can openly state some prophecy so that I can finally be freed from this foolishness? Because I would rather be free. I don't want to live a life anything like... How in any God... How can you, you know, with God, anybody, any man, want to even want something like that? I mean, that is not a curse, and it's not a gift, is per se. It would be maybe a curse and a gift to that individual, that's for sure, in some aspects, on both variations. Couldn't even imagine it. I mean, I do not want to see balls of flame falling from the sky and hurting people. That would make me sick inside, and it would make me cry horrendously. It would make me broken inside horrendously for to see something like that. to see suffering on that magnitude. I'm not on the other parts of the world. I do remember and recall one thing that I had happened when I was driving with that lady in the vehicle. If any of you had watched the video I was speaking of with the angel that came in my dream, I did remember telling her that around my age of 30, just after 30, 31, 32 years old, I'm going to try to explain this without sounding like a complete nut, but the best way to explain it is I had no confidence as a child, or very little. I was very happy and fortunate and thankful and give gratitude to every part of my life in that, but confidence eluded me a lot of the time, and it was a great heartache and difficulty to get through when I would go into classrooms with new kids and that and find myself choking up because I couldn't even talk. That negativity stemmed from a beratement of voice that at one time may have been outwardly from family and people saying, you know, like, what's wrong with you? You're not getting your shit together, you know, judging you. As a child, growing up, the mistakes that you make, and everybody makes, that I've seen my children make, and probably my grandchildren will make, but I didn't know these things as a child, and not having a lot of anybody around standing beside you to kind of guide you in a lot of these things, with these knowledge to share, it's very complicated in life. So I took that voices from people around, I guess, and I imagine I made it my own voice, because in my 20s even, I remember having the confidence of standing in the mirror and berating myself for saying or doing something stupid in around amongst people. Like, I felt like I was trying to live a perfect life and not say dumb, stupid things to make myself look a fool. Maybe that saying stuck with me too long. It was Samuel Clemens who wrote, I'm going to shorten it, but it is best to sit quiet and perhaps look the fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. And I spent my life, in school, everybody knows that if you say the wrong thing, you get attacked by children, and some kids, it's not a bother by them. Their emotion areas are so stable, let's call it, I don't know, but for me, I was overly emotional, and maybe it hurt me more, I don't know, the beratement, and it hurt me when I seen other children being hurt. I felt their pain too, it drove me crazy. The only times I ever got into a physical altercations as a child was when somebody else was being beat up. And a couple of those instances, it was 2-1. And that person left, and it was... Anyway. So that voice, the voice that became my own, the negativity, the beratement, that voice that would attack me horrendously. I'd look into the mirror, and I would find myself saying, why did you say that, you stupid, dumb, idiot, like... abusive on my own self. And it was around the age of 30 that I said the way I described it as killing the voice or destroying it, but really that doesn't happen. The voice is there for all your life. It just becomes much, much weaker until it's merely a whisper, an annoyance, a pesky mosquito in your ear. When that negativity that creeps arises behind you, that voice that perhaps comes from you, perhaps maybe Satan lives on a level of understanding that we're not aware of. Maybe he has his minions, we'll call them, or his own angels, we'll call them, whatever they may be, and they live just out of our visual aspects. Perhaps the voices that sometimes we hear that become a part of our own voices is not our own voices and gets mixed up with our own voices. Whatever the case may be, I found myself an ability at the age of 30 to cancel that voice out. It was not an easy thing, and it did take a period of time to do so. And I'm thankful for it. And it's a constant battle. I'm not going to say that I don't kick myself in the ass for saying or doing something wrong, but I quickly annihilate any kind of beratement. I may say something to myself in a negative aspect to remind myself that I'm repeating the same mistake a couple of times too many, you know, or whatever the case may be, or a reminder of slowing down, or I guess the voice is definitely way lessened to a degree. I don't even hear it, but when it was around, I used to attack myself unfairly and judge myself unfairly, ways that I would never do my children, never do to my family, never do to my friends. This voice that I encapsulated and allowed to live with me for a period of years, and I think that voice attached to me became attached to me the days that I did play with that witchcraft stuff, that satanic, it's Satan stuff. That's the best way to describe it. I actually believed that I was stronger than anything else as a child. I was wandering aimlessly, lost. I didn't have any answers. I went to church, I prayed, I became a Christian at a young age even. I remember even going out and telling and speaking outwardly about Jesus. And even in some instances, I have stories where I actually professed to a police officer in a Boston Pizza. And it was quite coincidental that later on, when I had lost, you know, any direction of that again, went off with my friends and became part of the world, and I was drinking and partying, and I was doing donuts, and I had a car full of friends, and I was pretty intoxicated, not probably enough that people see where you won't step, but I knew I was, and I was driving with everybody loaded in the car as a kid, 16 probably, and wouldn't you know it, the police that pulled me over was the same, very same officer from months prior, and he remembered me, and he told me to take it home, and I was given an opportunity and a chance where I could have gone through the system and became a nightmare of issues, and I am very thankful to that man, that officer, but he was more than an officer, he was a person too. He seen me as a person too, and that was a great thing, because I don't see officers doing that now. When I sit and try to speak to officers, I feel like they have to put a wall between me and them. And I feel that's wrong. I feel hurt by that because they're segregating us into something as animalistic, like they're being taught to push us away, to become unemotional. And how wrong can you be in that line of work to push that upon these men to become unemotional? And how does that transfer over to their wives and children? Well, you know, go look at their rates of divorce for police. It is quite high. I don't know, or I couldn't even comprehend. I guess I am trying to speculate, but the nuances, the things that they have to go through every day, the things that they have to see every day, must be very hard. The difficulty, the overworkedness, you know, there is not enough for the amount of people. That we live in a society that is so corrupted that they're training them to look at us as something other than. At one time they used to run into an opened area and see